Hello and welcome to my review of Bill, the Galactic Hero by Harry Harrison. Harrison is the author of the popular series Stainless Steel Rat and Death World, neither of which I have any recollection of. Bill, the Galactic Hero was published in 1965 and was one of Harrison's earlier novels, though as far back as the 1950s. His short stories were all over the same sort of periodicals, outstanding, amazing science fiction, that Robert Heinlein started in. The book starts with Bill dreaming of a lucrative career in farm animal waste disposal. He's forcibly recruited into the space troopers. He then attends boot camp, spends some time idling aboard ship, before getting lost on a planet city and falling into his dream job of waste disposal once again. He then gets involved in a revolution, convicted of desertion, and finally sees action once again against the hated alien Chingers. Now, the reason I picked this book up, some of you may have already noticed some hints, is that this book is often described as a satire of Robert Heinlein's Starship Troopers. Harrison certainly seems to have taken as a starting point Alexei Panshin's description of Starship Troopers as a patch recruiting film. This is stronger in the first 50-60 pages of the book, where the Heinlein connection is more obvious. We see, like Johnny Rico, Bill's rampant libido is, in part, the cause of his recruitment. Harrison writes, the cause of it all is the burning pressure of heterosexuality, which certainly calls to mind the gee golly attitude of Johnny Rico. Bill stops to admire the buttocks of the appropriately named Inga Maria Calafigia, and is simply in the wrong place at the wrong time. Like Heinlein's Space Marines, the space troopers are keen on their military music and have perfected it to a kind of brainwashing, and the description of the one robot band, rather cheating the intent of a one-man band with its multitude of appendages, isn't the last time this book will remind you of Terry Pratchett. Those who have read Heinlein will recognise the tropes. The madcap Pratchettisms like this add another degree of humour, but the novel is intended to strip away the veneer Troopers paints over the military, and Harrison is an ex-serviceman himself. When the new recruits, seduced by the shiny buttons and bright uniforms, are marched away to their boot camp, Harrison does this literally. The command robot moved its metronome up a notch, and the tramping boots conformed to the smarter pace, and the men began to sweat. By the time they reached the copter station, it was nearly dark. Their red paper uniforms hung in shreds, the gilt had been rubbed from their pot metal buttons, and the surface charge that repelled the dust from their thin plastic boots had leaked away. They looked as ragged, weary, and miserable as they felt. The bleakness of the satire here, the piling up of the misery and fakery, is quite effective, almost Dickensian, though without the razor-edged prose. Like Heinlein's Camp Curry, this is a boot camp determined to weed out the undesirables, despite the efforts made to recruit them in the first place. We read about sackcloth and sandpaper uniforms, rock wall mattresses, and floors refrigerated to make life even more unpleasant. The description of the transformation of the local town from agricultural to an entirely different type of CD, under the rationale of attempting to entertain the troops, is amusing enough, and also a clear callback to the various civilian towns visited by Rico and Starship Troopers. While Heinlein says it's nice how the civilians work two jobs to make a trooper's life more pleasant, Harrison insists it is far from it, transforming an undertaker's into a brothel and having the troopers drinking shots of embalming fluid. It doesn't just hint at the future of these unwilling recruits, it also again piles up misery, death, and dishonesty. The action is also far grislier than Heinlein's sterile depiction of military life, a point also satirised in Verhoeven's movie. And like many of Heinlein's protagonists, Bill plays only a minor role in the action, especially early on. He's a fuse tender on the ship, replacing fuses as they blow, a job the military typically regards as requiring a year's training, but only Gatchley gives 24 hours to do. Harrison again hammers this point home. This is a future war with some truly terrible developments in weaponry, demonstrated vividly when the fuse room is hit. After some largely unintentional heroics, Bill is one of a handful of survivors. Bill loses an arm and the surgeon fixes him up with another arm I sewed on. There were lots of them left over after the battle. Unfortunately, Bill lost a left arm and they're in short supply, but due to a surfeit of right, Bill ends up with two of those. However, from the point where Bill gets lost on the Imperial capital, the jabs at Heinlein become less obvious, and what's left feels largely aimless. There's an ecological message when Bill gets involved in the waste disposal team, and they discover that by dumping their trash in another system's sun, they've actually caused a supernova. Then there's the revolution, where it transpires that only one revolutionary wasn't spying on the revolutionaries for the GBI. None of which quite matches the spirit of the first act. Instead, we reach the point where the humour consists of calling distant planets far offier and distanter, and the Pratchettisms are few and far between, and none better than Bill stuffing his GBI payoff money into a rubber cat and Harrison explaining that, bit by bit, the kitty grew. When Bill is on trial, the repeated insistence that they hurry up as the judge has a tee-off time he wants to reach, it lends a real sense that the bottom of the barrel has been reached. Bill then becomes a military prisoner due to his desertion, eventually ending up on the hellhole Veneria, a jungle planet that does bring back a sense of the Heinlein, especially when a trooper in powered armor hits the swamp and immediately sinks and drowns, watched with total disinterest by his comrades. But this Veneria is a place of futile war, where 100 square miles is all that 10 years of bitter slaughter has won for humanity. A jungle full of predators and innumerable unseen enemies, it seems that this section is quite likely a commentary on Vietnam, which at the time of publication was developing rumbles of being unwinnable. In 2019, it just doesn't quite have the same impact. All in all, Bill the Galactic Hero is only sporadically amusing after a spirited first act. My concern would be that if you are unfamiliar with Starship Troopers, then even that section might not carry the same impact. The second half of the book, culminating in the revelation that this is literally screw your buddy day every day now for Bill, is a curious closure for an anti-war book. Bill starts as a bit of a simpleton, but when the book ends, has turned into a disinterested killer who ruthlessly exploits his own family. With half his body missing and augmented by robotics, it makes the loss of humanity message clear enough, but it's a disappointing end for Bill, who even 30 or 40 pages ago was still decent enough at heart. In truth, it also seems that it isn't war that breaks him, nor his conversation with the Chingers on why humans fight, which includes the Heinleinism, man can't be tamed. It's more the military justice that brings his change on, as it happens more or less on arrival at the military prison. People that like their humour on the black side will certainly get something from it, and it's not that long that the weaker sections become unbearable, but that's hardly a glowing reason to recommend a book. I think Pratchett diehards might enjoy bits of this too, but if you're not a science fiction fan as well, perhaps not enough to make it worth your while. Likewise, Heinlein fanboys will probably not enjoy having someone poke a paper bayonet at their hero, so I struggle to see who the audience was for this in the 1960s, let alone today. I do like Harrison's style of writing. He has a certain cold-blooded wit that I enjoyed, enough that I've ordered another of his books to check out. But overall, this seems like an inspired premise with less inspired execution. If your needs are specifically for madcap sci-fi adventure with an anti-war message, then Slaughterhouse-5 is the place to start.